ஹலோ, சொல்லுங்க மேம். ஓகேங்க, தேங்க்யூ.
Afternoon participants, are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. We will start. Now we have taken an FBP, which is on building a decision support system for a sustainable agriculture using data science. Now there are 3 to 4 things. First is agriculture, and that agriculture has to be sustainable, and that will be done only with the help of a support system, and that support system type is a decision based using the data science. So for this FBP, we welcome you all on board. Now here we will be narrowing down a little bit on to what are the role of data science in the agriculture. Now if you just have a look at the graph, it shows you you can just see a world population from 1950 to 2010. And then beyond 2010, you can see 3 projections where you can have a different coloring, where you can see the past, low, medium, and the high. Let us stick on to the line which is very, very high. Now, when you
your audio is gone.
Hope now it is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Now, as we navigate, you can see the graph which we were talking about. Now, the UN actually projects that the world population will near 9.7 billion by 2050. And the UN's Food Agriculture Organization, they have estimated about 60% more food per year
will be demanded by 2050. Now just put everything into a context. In just a 30-year period, now all of us on Earth will be starving for food. Now there would have been 2000 years to reach this particular level. But within a span of 30 years, the food starvation might be an outburst. Now in the next three decades, as we have seen, there is a 70% increase in food availability has to be made in order to meet the demand for the increasing population. So what we have to do, at least 69% you have to increase your agricultural production. And the global food system, no, that has to change profoundly if it is going to provide humanity with a healthy food, which is grown sustainably in many ways, that are not only resilient in the face of climate change, but also do not surpass your planetary boundaries. So definitely you need to have a healthy food, a sustainable one, and then even it has to be resilient in the face of any climate change. And ultimately, the UN Sustainable Development Goal, no, they have fixed by 2030, the world should be without, or the world with zero hunger. A world without hunger, or a world with zero hunger, that is what exactly the phrase they have mentioned. What do you mean by that? They strive to make more productive, efficient, sustainable, inclusive, transparent, resilient food systems. That is what is expected of scientists and engineers or researchers like us. Now, you have to also look into the factors which drive the innovation in the field of agriculture. Now, the future of agriculture, you could have seen or you could have had an insight. Just like take a look at the past. A few years back, we had abundant people working on the farms, producing lot of agricultural produces, which were all consumed. And the cycle was very much well balanced between the producer and the consumer. Right now, what has happened is more number of natural factors which are not favorable for cultivating the crops or agriculture, or because of laborious things, or maybe because of several other local issues or the climate issues, people have slowly drifted to other work. So consumers are more in number, and the future, no, the past is really, and just looking at a balance between the past and the future is really a shock. So what will be the future of agriculture? So unless you have a lot of methods, tools and machinery to cope up with on a continuous improvement, like let us talk about your nanotechnology, or you talk about your sensors, digital, any technology, find out some technology on Earth so that you can very well find it out. Now, as you can see from the figure, you can see the population living in countries which will have kilocalorie per person per day. You can see a steep rise where this will be the thing which they will be reaching. Now, this is just a look at the food consumption per capita on the various commodity between the three worlds, the well-developed and the developing worlds, and by and large, whatever the case may be, by 2050, you can see almost in all the things, you know, there is a rise. So definitely we have to do some technology. Okay, now let us also try to find out from the past how the technology revolution has changed the farming. Now, there might be some game changers in the earlier ones. So we will try to analyze that so that we will be in a position to predict the future or do something in the future. Now, just to have a look at the earlier one technology, you can see the Green Revolution in the 1960s, which was done by US Vice President Henry Wallace. So they spearheaded something known as a new irrigation and crop management techniques, just done by Dr. Norman Borlaug, and that was how they had made enough food during that particular period. Then there was a second wave 1974, where you could have seen the original single active ingredient Roundup herbicide was released. Now this was purely based on glyphosate based herbicide in order to control the weed in the crops, so that they can kill the weeds and then they can focus more onto the good crops. Then in 75, the rotary combines were introduced and created by Sperry New Holland. And what happened was they were able to cut the crop and separate in one pass over the field. So that way, say for example, if it is a corn, they separated not only the husk and the ears, they could shell the kernels and chop the stalks. So that was a great thing. It had speeded up the work. Then in 1982, first genetically modified plant cell was done by the scientist at Monsanto company. And they had created a new gene, introduced a new gene into the petunia plant. And this was an agrobacterium. And this agrobacterium actually went inside and genetically modified the crops, especially the tomato, which was very much resistant to the herbicide, insects, virus, everything. That was a very big, great breakthrough. Then definitely all of us know about the satellite technology in 94, which had helped the farmers to see their farms overhead and allowing them to better track and plan through the satellites. And in 1996, Monsanto, first GMO crops. Now you might be wondering, what is this GMO? Genetically modified organism. Crops became commercially available, especially, the soya beans, and they had the insect protected cotton, all were produced during this particular period. Then comes the software and mobile devices, which were helping farmers to have a better harvest. Now, normally farmers, when they go into the field, they had to be separated, but these mobile devices were helping them to stay connected with their fellow personnel. And they had all the data in hand and they were able to either place order for a seed or a fertilizer or sell their product or something like that, even their producers. And later on, in 2050, we saw the data which is revolutionizing the farming potential, where you can see the decisions were based on the information they have on hand. And the data has helped them harness the power of information to make better informed decisions and allow them to use the resources sustainably. And this is where the you can talk about the Climate Corporation's field view. It's a platform, where it's a platform which brings together data collection, agronomic modeling, local weather monitoring, and gives the farmers a better understanding to make a better thing. Ultimately, all the researchers or all these things, what has been the thread, which has been the core thread, which has been running is sustainable intensification of agriculture as the technology is being pulled or dragged into it seamlessly. And they were also trying to find out how the game-changing technologies can be used. Now, these game-changing technologies, they are either transformative or revolutionize the way we do, or whatever earlier we had done, address the problem and then eliminate them or minimize them if not. So that is what we had been discussing. Now, as you just scroll through the game-changing technologies, what they are supposed to do. Now, the game-changing technology, you have to be very careful whether it is an elementary research or development in any of the physical science, engineering, or computer science. It can be taken from evolution of the devices, sensors, and systems. It can be for analytics and better production abilities, or it can be applied research. And it can be an assistance and instruction to the farmers on how to use new technologies. It can do anyone among this. Ultimately, what we are trying to do, we are trying to aid the farmers in the application of the scarce resources and optimal utilization of the fertilizer and pesticides, and so that it can yield a high crop productivity and they can reduce the impact on the natural ecosystems, and they can have a less run of chemicals into rivers and groundwater. Not only that, it can increase the safety of workers. So now we have an idea what we have to do. So that is where data science comes into picture. Now, this is all of you who would have known what is a data science. It is actually a interdisciplinary field. Now, this interdisciplinary field has conquered industries around the world. Now, this is what has been paid for the fourth industrial revolution. Now, what happens is there is a massive explosion in data, and there is a need for us to create a better product. So we are ending up in a data-driven society. Now here, how it has become a data-driven, one person has to have a domain knowledge, the computer science knowledge, then mathematical and statistical aptitude. All the three are to be combined. Now when you just overlap them, definitely you can see some points like here, the client requirements, important criteria, easier explanation for the domain knowledge. Likewise, from statistical knowledge to the regression, the models for the machine learning. Then for computer science, you can see database up to data infrastructure. Now, all the overlapping, you know, overlapping, and you're slowly narrowing down from the outer peripheral to the core, you can see this is where data science lies at the intersection of all this. So what is data science? Data science is a process, and this process will help us in collecting data and preparing or processing it, then analyzing it, modeling it, and then from there visualize or communicate after the inference, and then it is put back as a feedback. So this is what you mean by the data science. Now there was one word we were talking about, it is a data-driven technology. What is meant by a data-driven technology? Now you have many things. Data is used to take a decision and then proceed further. So everything is centered only on data. The technology which is being used here is data-centric. Like you talk about the anyone among the earlier things, you know, you can talk about. So why this population is vulnerable, or why there is a food security? It is because of increasing population. The arable land area is decreasing. There's a change in climate. Food is wasted. Then the standards that focus on consumer preference for animal protein has to be changed. It's getting changed. Farm profitability, which is critical to incentivize the food production. All these things are there. Now, what we have to do, you have to handle the data effectively. Now, having understood the principles or having understood what we are to be protective or vulnerable, and based on this vulnerability, what are the solutions? We have to handle the data effectively. Definitely, we need data modeling. Now, you might be wondering, what is a data modeling? Now, data modeling is actually an attempt to understand something by creating a likeness. Now it can be an architectural scale model, or it can be a map of Macedonia, or mathematical equations, or it can be a representation of the reality, or it can be in any way. It can be a mental, verbal, graphical, physical, mathematical, and so on. And it can be a hypothesis also. Now this is how the data and decision tools at farms are being made. You can see the public data is available, the landscape of data and tools are here. Then here you can see the farm level data and tools. So all these are taken care in the model, and from the model decision is being made. So this is from one of the paper which has been picked up, a model. Now there are explicit modelings which lead us to detail our assumptions, examine their consequences, integrate expertise across disciplines, or the statistical models, they provide exploratory or inferential structure like similarity, pattern, relationship, treatment improvement, and so on. Then it can be a mechanistic modeling which provides additional tools for extrapolation and projection, decision and control. Now why we need mathematical models are, the mathematical models are very much needed for us because they are quick and easy, and it is cheap. They can simplify the complex scenarios. They can improve understanding of real world situation. They allow predictions, they provide future projections. The model does not include all aspects of the world problem, and there might be limitations which have to be considered. So as you navigate through and you are trying to find out a research problem or you are trying to solve something, first and foremost, try to understand how to model a real-time problem. So this is just a tidbit how to do it. Recognition of the real-world problem is stage one. Then devise any model. It can be any one of the models which has been already listed out. Like it can be mental, verbal, graphical, physical, mathematical, and so on. It can be hypothesis or anything, or a statistical model. Then stage three is model used to make your prediction. Collect the data. Stage four, compare what you have observed against the devised model. Maybe you would have done a model, no? So in that model, you use that model to observe or conduct experiment, collect the data for the observed experimental ones, compare some devised model. Statistical test can be used to check how well the model describes the real world problem. In case there is a change, refine your model. So this is what has to be done. Just to read for yourself what is being listed out here. Now you very well know information is power, and the industry can now have access to it for more informed decision making, and there are many ways in which data analysis can help us. So either you can develop new seed traits or do precision farming, or you can track your food, or you can have some effect on your supply chain. And the rest I just want you to read for yourselves because they are quite explanatory. I'll just give you a couple of minutes. Please read to it. So let me go to the next slide. Now, how is big data analytics transforming agriculture? Now, you have to have a look at how big data is.
And you can also start going there.
Now, it is trying to boost your productivity. It gives access to plant genome information, and it helps us in giving us predicting the yields. Just read.
insect, whatever. And probably it's a to start with it, it can be a solution that goes so I'm okay.
Next is risk management, food safety and savings. Okay, now we will, I was not narrating the things because it is all very theoretical part, which all of us very well know. And here, what I just wanted to mention was, there are several models. Now, when you look at the models which are developed, you know, for knowledge derivation from the available data, you can just have a look at farm models, crop models, ecological models, land use models. So that was in the beginning of 2003 to 2010, these models were more prominent. And later on, no, from 2000 to 2012, no, they were building modeling frameworks. And this was a method of combining, no, they were trying to look at how to combine and more comprehensive analysis for a decision making. And this was involving IT and computational innovations, no, for rapid analysis of large amount of data. That is where they found out it was very difficult when the computational power was very less and data was just kept on pumping in a variety of ways, voluminous. And not only that, it was all the six V's, you know, which we were seeing on the screen right now. So you can very well see, you know, that during that particular period, people started feeling the data processing, data analysis, and the high level of linkage of the model, the abstract modeling framework, especially when they were talking about the conceptual interoperable model. You know, anything you take as a solution, it was very, very problematic. That is where people started using the big data. Now, the big data, when it was applied, I mean, just talking in terms of only the application to the agricultural domain. So, all of us knew voluminous data from a variety of sources which were structured, semi-structured and unstructured, and at a rapid speed. Not only that, the degree of trusting the data was also the veracity problem, the value, what is the value it has, business value it has to the thing. Now here it is, what is of importance from the agricultural context and the variety, how it can be formatted. So that was the thing. Now all these models, you know, if you just look at the big data from the agricultural context, so it was all, they were all collected from various places like satellite, sensor network, social media, observation by the people or the farmers, then existing databases. So all these were the raw material from which some added meaning was taken by analysis and integration or modeling, artificial intelligence, then semantic web technologies were used in order to gain a what is a impact assessment, what is a decision support system, and how this particular information which you have garnered can be put on an application. And finally, you can get the wisdom for the decision makers so that any societal challenges can be made. Now, this particular thing is only for the, not only for the agro-environmental science, it is for any field. And hence the government, you know, they also started feeling, oh, alarmingly it is going around. So definitely there has to be something which has to be done. And the trend was, people started understanding we need a multidisciplinary integrative research for the decision making, and also there is a pressure on the timeline. Then the data has to be made as public as possible, and we had to use all the technological developments. More focus was emphasized on to the remote sensing or the things. Even then it was very costly, so people tried to come down. So we had to go for open access repositories of images, the advances of the mobile phone, which enabled the crowdsourcing and digital connectedness through IoT. And the computational resource was also increasing according to the Moore's law. But what was happening was the storage and computational resources were unable to be stationed down, and it had to be put to the cloud, either as platform as a service or model as a service. Now, all this was not possible by individuals. Hence, government understood and they started initiating lot of things. So they felt the data analysis and the data analytics have to be made in order to develop a new seed trait or do precision farming or track your food or effect on the supply chain, whatever it is, just name it from the agro context, anything. So they felt it has to be a collective opinion, it has to be a collective thing. And when you talk about the, what do I say, like boosting your productivity, predicting the yield, risk management, food safety, savings, anything on the data analytics side, the government had to intervene. Now, as you find out, now there is a population around 1.5 billion, I said, in the beginning. And NASSCOM was also trying to say, by a study which was conducted, saying Indian analytic industry is predicted to reach $16 billion by 2025. So government started realizing and put initiatives like Niti Aayog, which is working on a plan in collaboration with the private players like the National Data and Analytic Platforms. And then they had the Big Data Management Policy, which was drafted by CAG for auditing. And then Ministry of Statistics and the program implementation, they proposed National Data Warehouse on Official Statistics, so that they can leverage the technology and use the analytical tools so that many beneficiaries can be obtained. And the Ministry of Agriculture, no, they signed a deal with ISRO to use the satellites for mapping agricultural assets. And there was a direct benefit transfer in MGNREGA to Aadhaar and Aadhaar for authentication and availing the welfare scheme, even to the even to the rural population. So smart city, digital India, digital economy, like that, many proposals and initiatives were all taken. Now ultimately, okay, now this is they understood. Now when you, as you travel, I'm not going through all these slides, you can read for yourself. Now as you traverse, the applications of big data are varied in number, like they are for governance, or they can give for your security agencies or police force to curb or to control the crime and criminal activities, or they can use it for educating, or they can use it for handling disasters, either natural, man-made, or any epidemic or pandemic situations. And they were also trying to boost the economy of the thing in terms of insurance sector, banking sector. Or to evade risk and minimize the loss, deregistration of lack of companies, prevent money laundering, terrorism, curbing the terrorism financing. So like that, all these had to be taken care, including healthcare. I think the COVID situation has exposed all of us to the healthcare data, which is very, very essential for us at the right moment to predict, to prescribe, to optimize the treatment, and to find out a new cure. So ultimately, if you just look at everything, but what is the first thing according to the Maslow's hierarchy theory? Food is the basic human need. Food, clothing, shelter. So that is how the low level starts with, as you grow till the socialist. Now in that, based on that theory or the hierarchy, let us focus on the big data, where you are about to seed selection, geotagging, in order to keep track of the record of agricultural assets in the country, weather forecasting, food processing, identification of crop diseases, irrigation and effective water management. Now, this is one particular area where you can very well see the applications where this is a combination of technology and analytics. The farming process, they are increasingly becoming data-enabled and data-driven. And traditional tools, they are gradually replaced by sensor-equipped machines. And these machines, they collect data from the environment to control the behavior. And the technology with the external big sources, you can see. Now you can see how they are able to control, how the sensing and monitoring, how they are planning. So this is combined with big data sources like weather data, market data, standards to contribute the rapid development of smart farming things like. Not only that, there are several stakeholders who are involved. Now you have to identify all the stakeholders and ensure that all of them are on a common platform, and they, either it is proprietary or an open source, you have to keep on welcoming more and more venture capital or business or farming or technology company, anything. They have to come under a single common roof. Only then we will be able to accomplish. This is what is projected in sustainable, or you talk about a zero world without hunger. So this is what can be done. So we have to replace all your food and feed with very good substitutes, then use a circular economy, intensify the agriculture, have safe inputs like your botanical or organic things, then use your digital agriculture and things like that. So with that, we will go with one of the parameter, which is a soil. Now, as you know, soil is actually a natural body which is composed of biota and air, water and minerals, which is developed from consolidated or semi, I don't say consolidated, unconsolidated or semi-consolidated material, and it forms the topmost layer of the earth's surface. Now, if you just look at the upper limit of the soil, either you will have air, shallow water, or you will have a plant material which is having life or which is on the verge of decomposing. And the lower limit of the soil, all of us know it is the presence of a hard rock or the lower limit of the biological activity. Now, what are the main functions of soil? Among the functions, you can see food and other biomass production, storage, filtering, transformation of water, gas and mineral, source of raw material, physical and cultural heritage, platform for mainland structures, and biological habitat and gene pool. Now, our focus will be on to these particular thing, like 1, 2, 3, more will be onto the biological habitat and the gene pool. Now, as you see, a person by Keith, he had stated that the key to optimization of decision making is to accurately account for uncertainty. Now, you have to, soil is of very uncertain right now. So you have to make, it might be due to various factors like pollutions which are getting added up either through water or through air, and this entire thing. You would have heard about many incidents where oil spills occur or something has burst out, a pipe has burst out, the soil gets flooded with oil. Now what will happen as it gets percolated, it might block. You have to handle this sort of a grave scenario. So that what we can do, using a data science, either you can digitally, you can do a digital soil and crop mapping, where what you can do is like you can build digital map for different soil type, their property, and you can very well make prompt updates and alerts in case something goes wrong with the soil which is already mapped. and you can give the farmers not only update, you can also tell them at this instant of time, this is the humidity in your soil, this is the water content or moisture content, and this is the water holding capacity. You can list out all the things, and then you can very well narrow down and tell them this is the crop which you can cultivate or which will be giving you a very high yield under a controlled condition. And next is you try to find out the features of cropping mapping. Every time you reap a crop, the soil structure definitely changes. Now you have to find a crop which will next suit the same soil type. Now earlier you could have heard of incidents where the soil is left to heal for some time so that no cultivation is done, and then it recovers back with the organic thing and then comes back. So that is what we are trying to find about. Then you have the soil delineations, and next you have the spatial accuracy of conventional soil polygon maps. All these are involving things related to the structure and the location of the soil over a period of time. Now, next major thing is you have to go ahead with soil testing. Now, you might be wondering why soil testing is required. Soil testing will help you evaluate the nutrient levels in the soil and to determine the fertility of the soil. How you will be able to find out all this? The data which you will have as an observation, or which will be recorded through the sensors, or which will be collected in some form or mechanism. So that is where you talk about, say for example, what is the amount of nutrient or fertilizer which is required to replenish the soil. So the soil testing can be made on site. It has to be fast, easy, accurate analysis. It has to be disseminated to the farmers in their understandable way to make an informed decision on the choice of crop patterns, what is a crop diversification, and what is the input such as seeds and fertilizer they can use. All these, you will be able to tell them only with your data science. And the quality also, you have to be, when you are giving them all the things, you have to ensure accuracy, adequacy, consistency, completeness, interoperability, across platforms, accessibility, and serving capacity has to be very well met out. Now, this is one particular figure which has been taken from one of the projects of LUCAS. Now, where you can see there is a sampling point from where the soil is picked up. So, the soil is split into two parts, and they are trying to find out what is the chemical and physical property, what is the biodiversity in this module, and here they are trying to calculate the bulk density and soil moisture, and here they are measuring the thickness of the organic layer and the quality check through taken photographs. Ultimately, everything is collected here so that a proper, from the data you have to get the information, from information you have to get knowledge, from knowledge you can get a wisdom. Wisdom will be used for the decision making. So that decision making will be, that is what I was talking in the pyramid, data pyramid. So this is what will be done over here. Now this is another representation of how a data analysis workflow will be looking like when you have modeled. Now here you can see the observational data from soil respiration of the different types of plots, or the plant activity of all these, or the soil conditions like temperature or moisture. Everything can be taken for statistical analysis. And after having analyzed them statistically, what you can do is you can model the strategies so that accordingly, what variable I can keep constant, what variable I can control, and as a result, how well I can get back or achieve the goal or thing which I need. Now, when a soil geographical database is taken, these are the usability which determines. You would think about the quality control. So here, then you have technical specifications, then decision makers, what they do, and the farmers. Then you have the stakeholders, three GIs, models, developers. Now, among them, these three stakeholders, if you just look at them, a decision maker like us, or maybe a developer like us, we will try to find out how to require a transformation. Is it up to date? How to use it? In which format is it? And whereas a decision maker or a person, maybe it can be a policy by the government or something, but to them, input is given from a researcher or a scientist. So what sort of questions they can answer? How reliable is it? the soil information system, what does it represent? How much is it costing? What are the production costs? And ultimately, the farmer, they will be looking from their point whether it is adding value or it is increasing the profit or it is just simply thinking or talking very much in terms. Now, these are the differences which has been mapped for the knowledge-driven soil mapping on your left-hand side. Now, here you can see the left-hand side, whereas here it is a data or technology-driven for the soil mapping on the right-hand side. Now, here, if you just look at the technology-driven, which is much better than the earlier one, which was a expert-based. Now, this is a completely automated. Now, here, you just see, they were trying to find out the types, but here you can analyze all the properties. Now, this was only for discrete. Now, it is continuous or hybrid. It can either give you the quantity or the probability. Now, here you can get a proximal soil sensing. But here, you can only have a expert knowledge. So, you have to wait for the expert. Then soil delineations. But here, everything is remotely controlled. So, here you can find out the spatial prediction. No? It can be per polygon or you can automate your geostatistics. Like that accuracy here, it is more better than the earlier one. Then data is represented either like a gridded maps or prediction error map. Whereas here you can see it is a conventional one. And the major technical aspect is a cartographic. Here it is a grid cell size. So the soil strategies, no? If you can see here, it is all design or model based sampling. So this is what we will be more focusing on from now on. Now, if you having said about this, I would also like to mention about a predictive soil mapping. Now, a predictive soil mapping, no, it is based on applying a statistical technique to fit the model for the purpose of producing the spatio-temporal prediction of the soil variables. Now, this will combine statistics, data science, soil science, physical geography, remote sensing, geo information science, and many other things. Now, if you have a predictive soil mapping with R, no, it you can combine R programming. So predictive soil mapping with R is one of the very good recent fields, which gives you a very good understanding about the main concepts behind soil mapping and how to produce high quality soil maps and how to optimize all the processes which are involved so that the production cost can be cut down. So all this is possible. Now, it is not only R, there are other things, other software which are can be used for finding out. So this is MRO, RStudio, R packages are there. Then you have the Saga GIS. Then you have the Google Earth or Google Earth Pro. Then you have QGIS. Then you have the GDAL. So this is the version and the release. So these are some of the software. Now this is how, no, from a data to a knowledge. So what happens is all the things are target variables are collected, data is parameterized, and then you estimate the model, then you do all your information mapping and things like that. You predict all locations, then you arrive, the predictions are satisfactory, then you give the knowledge for decision making or scenario testing or uncertainty assessment. If not, rework or have a feedback. So this is no mapping process. Now this mapping process, when you are talking about this particular thing, no, you select the okay. Now we'll pass on to the mapping process of a knowledge-driven soil mapping. No, now here as you go through, sample the study area, assign soil types, derive the DEM parameters, develop fuzzy rules relating to the distribution of soil classes, to the auxiliary variables, implement fuzzy rules to allocate soil classes for each grid location, generate soil property values for each soil class using representative observations, estimate values of the target soil variable to each grid location using a weighted average of allocated soil class or membership. Now, what are the key advantages? No? We have started with an automated soil mapping. What are the key advantages? Now, all the rules which are required to produce outputs have been formalized. They are documented, the procedures, and you enable a reproducible research. Second advantage is all the predicted surfaces, they can use very various information sources and they can be optimized, you know. And there is more flexibility in terms of spatial extent, resolution, and support of maps. And automated mapping is more cost effective also. Then the next advantage, if you just look at it, is spatial prediction models typically provide quantitative measures of prediction uncertainty, which are often not provided in case of conventional soil mapping. Now, this is a general decision tree where you can, in a predictive soil mapping project, where you can see the user phase one user inventory is made. Now, phase two, there is an implementation plan. Phase three, they acquire the sample. Phase four, they prepare your input data sets. Then they build the model and predict in the phase five. Then phase six, they have a quality control. And finally, phase seven, they make a data publication and distribution. Now, this is another thing which is a recommended decision tree for designing a predictive soil mapping project. Now, the same thing, but in a different way of depiction. You can just go through it. Just navigate from here. The same thing in a different form. I'll just give you 1 minute. Navigate or just go through the flowchart. Yes, you have gone through. Now, this is another map after the thing, no? Land GIS. They have taken and built it. You can very well see how they have done it. Now, this is a global land information system, which is built on top of the land GIS concept, where you can very well see all your soil data, live weather channel, plant monitoring channel, social economic data, all are collected into a global information system from where you can have a global model library, and that can be accessed by a farmer from any location. Even the field data in turn can be collected from here and it can be sent to them. You can update in case it is, so whenever they want, they can access it, and whenever they need to update also, they can update the platform. Now, for soil, so far we have been dealing with the various, or trying to give you a look and feel of the different models which are prevalent, and how I've just listed out one or two models which has been picked up and trying to say how they are being worked out using the data science concepts. Now, we will just go to watering and irrigation. Now all of us know there is a study by World Wildlife Fund. Now they say water is becoming very scarier and scarce worldwide, and they are predicting that 1/3 of the total population will end up facing water crisis in 2025. And water bodies, no, though they are covering 70% of the total planet, no, it's only 3% of it is fresh water, which is potable and which can be used. And not only potable, that is the water which can be used to cultivate the crops till now. And there are many technologies which are trying to cultivate using seawater itself, which is very salty. They are trying to cultivate crops in seawater. So I'm not talking about that technology. I'm talking about the normal conventional ones. Now with the shrinking water reservoir, low rainfall, and with all this, definitely as a data analyst or data scientist or as a data science personnel, you have to analyze in helping to take a meaningful action so that the smart water system is being used to reduce the consumption of water, which is non-renewable, and you have to ensure that water scarcity is dealt at the grassroots level, and the stress, water stress condition, no? You have to handle it in a careful and in a very, very effective way. Now, what we try to do is you try to automate your irrigation system to minimize the consumption of water. Many techniques will be there. How to make a thing. Now, as you navigate through, no, you can very well find out an automated irrigation system. Now, this automated irrigation system, what happens is it is based on a small scale farm, and it will also use your weather predictions. Now, here they collect input from remote sensing, artificial intelligence, geographic information system, and data science. All the fields or all the disciplines are working together, and they try to maneuver the data science and the thing, what are the opportunities in which you can reduce the water consumption. So as you do it, you can also find out with minimal water how a plant can survive, and with minimal water how the plant can grow. So with minimal, everything will be finally burned down or completely brought down to a minimal. Not only that, irrigation is also very irregular at times. So in case there is an irregular irrigation, how to manage? Now, right now, when you have a very good monsoon in the country, definitely all the areas will be having abundant water supply, and based on which crops, seeds will be sown and crops will be cultivated till harvest. If it is there, then it is fine. And there may be pockets which will be depending on only the monsoon. They will not have any other water source. So how are they going to handle this? So decision process has to be involved. For that decision process, definitely you have to assess the state of nature, like what is the weather, what is the crop attribute, how this can be selected, how to make a better thing. And not only that, you have to collect trials of different vegetable crops, develop a novel data-driven mathematical models, use data analytical algorithm, and then you try to get an information, then give it to the irrigation decision makers. Only then that will be very good. You might be wondering, there is one particular thing, a newly emerging academic field known as irrigation informatics. Now this irrigation informatics, no, they talk about specialties like science of information, practice of information processing, engineering your information system to advance a biophysical science or engineering field. And they try to find out how the world prediction, when it is doubling, the irrigation efficiency should increase. Then new lands for irrigation should also be taken into consideration. So it is very, very difficult. So that is what even you feel that this land cannot be cultivated because lack of water and there is no possibility of water. You try to find out some creative method by which this can be also taken into consideration for the cultivation. So that is what is being done with the water, irrigation informatics. Now, this is one particular framework of factors which affect the farmer's decision. Now, here you can see the most important factor which is influencing is the generation of income from different activities. The farmers, know they choose their production, crop production activity according to the crop profitability. And the primary factors can be something like production cost, yield, price, which is received for the produced crop. So all this will help them in making a decision to cultivate a particular area with a particular crop. That is how they are conventionally doing. So this you have to ensure it is completely automated or taking. So this is where the decision making is being done. So all the other things you will have to collect it, process it, get necessary information from the raw data, from there how to get the knowledge, and from there how to get your proper decision making and inform the farmers on that. Now there are several models, intelligent practices which for the irrigation, prediction irrigation. Now you might be wondering, there is a linear programming technique which is used to make decisions about irrigation water management options in conjunction with optimal cropping pattern, which will ensure optimal utilization of land and water resources in irrigation projects. Not only that, you also have several other models like logistic regression, decision tree classifier, SIS4, SVM, remote sensing and crop models, ANFIS, ARIMA, FUSSY, then genetic algorithm, decision support system, artificial neural network, and so on. So all these are helping us for the irrigation system. Okay, now you know the technology, you know the data science, what can be done. Now let us focus on to one particular scenario as we have been doing in the soil case. Now how this irrigation system can be subdivided or categorized? Sprinkler irrigation, where there will be a single point from where it gets sprinkled. Surface irrigation, where you apply the water down the furrow through tubes, and from there you flood the irrigation basin. Then drip irrigation, where near the root you try to find out what is the best soil type and field slope and field geometry and water resource which can be done. So among the three categories, okay, now that you know this is a system for delivering the irrigation water. Now here you can very well see an automated, before we go for an automated, let us look at the subsurface drip irrigation. Now in the subsurface drip irrigation, it is a method that allows farmers, they are controlled when and how much water their crops will receive. And this can be paired with increasingly sophisticated IoT sensors, or enable sensors to continuously monitor the moisture level and the plant health. And the farmers will definitely be able to intervene only when necessary, and other things will be automated. So that is what you can very well see, the valves, the filter, all the equipment. So you can very well see how the SDI is being done, the subsurface drip irrigation. Now this you can see the different configurations, how the water is being made. Now before we go to the irrigation scheduling tools, I would also try to mention about the design criteria you have to keep in mind while you are designing an SDI system. You have to look at what are the water requirements. When I just look at the water requirements, I have to have a data which will be calculated about, which will be trying to quantify what is the required flow rate and what is the water supply which is adequate to deliver the amount of water over a particular growing season. And it has to look at the climate, the crop and the soil, accordingly design. So that is the first point when I'm looking for a design criteria. What is the water requirement? Second criteria, I have to look at the climate. When I look at the climate, I have to think about whether it's a humid area or not. What is a reduced, if it is a more arid region, then what is a reduced vapor pressure gradient? Or what is the driving force for evapotranspiration? And what is the temperature, sunshine, wind influenced evapotranspiration? All this you have to look at it. Then the third design criteria for taking any data-based data science using, the crop you have to think about. Crop, you have to find out what is the particular crop, what it requires in terms of water, or what is the season, and what is the probability whether that particular region will have an appreciable rain during a day period, and what is the high dependability, then what is the design flow rate, and what is expected, the crop will be expecting such a designed water flow to its roots. But maybe you would have, the manufacturer would have had a specific drip line. This drip line flow rate will be not having enough pressure and the water will not be sufficient. So that discrepancy, how you are going to tackle or nullify them. Then definitely the soil. Soil we have been discussing earlier, so I'm not going to discuss about this. So definitely while you are looking at your design criteria, just look at water requirements. So for water requirement, you will be looking at climate, crop, soil. And the second thing is you will have to look at the management and operation considerations. Now find out whether all the people will be able to use it on a same crop, or it's on a rotation of multiple crops, or one crop divided into several areas. So how they are managing, how they are deploying the different crops in a rotation, and what is the different cropping systems, and whether subsoiling is a part of the production system, and they have to ensure whether the system is maintaining properly, like flushing, acid injection, iron settling, all this they have to look at. So you have to look at the management and operation consideration of the soil. Then definitely the water quality. Because we have been discussing about water. Water quality, if it is not good, then there is no point in having. So you have to find out what are the salts which will be able to build near the root zone, and what is the amount of leaching requirement which has to be ensured or it has to be removed, and what is the emitter clogging which is of a primary concern, no? And what is the water quality which will be dictating the filtration requirements, chemical injection requirements, and management of systems to prevent emitter clogging. All these things you have to take into consideration as a data scientist. These are the parameters to work out any one of your earlier models which has been given over here. Okay. Now let us pass on to the irrigation scheduling tools, which are very freely available. And the weather data is used to calculate an amount of water. Water that would be evaporated by a reference crop, and then a crop coefficient is used to scale that reference value to a specific crop. Now here you see a particular thing known as a soil water. What is soil water today? It can be represented by an equation of soil water. What is the soil water of yesterday minus withdrawal plus what is the input you are giving on that particular day. That decides what is the soil water of today. So you have to ensure that evapotranspiration is being controlled in a proper way. So you have to ensure the deep percolation. What are the minor withdrawals? what is negligible, what is not negligible, all these things should be taken care. So water balance should be ensured. The same soil water should be there consistently if it is required, taking into consideration all the other things. Next thing you have to look at the water content. Now water content, definitely you have a lot of things in the water. Now say for example, you talk about the soil water level. When it is a sandy soil, you definitely know there are larger particles in pore and the water will not be holding tightly. Therefore, to the soil, no, it will be very much less reduced. But as you navigate from the coarse sand to the clayey soil, definitely the water holding capacity among the soil will be more in this particular thing. Especially, no, it is speaking in loams. Then silt loams, it is slightly lesser than the loams. And gradually it decreases till the clay. But for the coarse sand, you can very well see it is an increase in available water capacity, inches of water per inches of soil profile. Now all this, you also have to maintain the soil water, taking into consideration a scheduling. Now how to schedule? For scheduling also, you try to measure with the rain gauge, what is the rainfall which will be received in that particular area, how it can be scheduled, what will be the field capacity, what will be the permanent wilting point. So try to ensure the soil, initial soil moisture is estimated properly, and then daily try to track with the observation, note it down, and then ensure it is always maintaining the same soil water. Now there are several projects, but want of time, let me skip to the next topic regarding the seeding and planting. Now, as you navigate through seeding and planting, in earlier days, it was a laborious manual process. But with modern agriculture, no, you have seeding machines which are very faster than a human. So you can use a scatter method, and it can be, now what happens when a person sows the seed manually, they will definitely use a scatter method. Now the scatter method will be inaccurate and wasteful when the seed falls outside the optimal location. You do not know which is the optimal location in the soil for it to effectively grow. So, and moreover, you have to ensure for effective seeding, planting seeds at the correct depth has to be made, and spacing of plants at appropriate distance also for the optimal growth. So how to ensure both, that is very, very difficult. So you need to have some mechanism like your geomapping or precision seeding equipments, which will maximize these variables and do it properly. And not only that, you also have to ensure you build some stronger seeds. Now we were talking in terms of the soil bed where you will be laying them down. Now after having the precision seeding methods, no, you for that also there are a lot of data science packages which are available, softwares which are available, to decide and talk about that. And not only this is sufficient, even the quality of the seeds are very, very much required. Now you have to find out the climate. Now in an unfavorable climate, you cannot grow crops to lead to poor harvest, and there is a decrease in the soil fertility. So what you have to do is you will have to procure seeds which can survive any climate, any soil condition or any temperature. So that can be done only with genetic editing. Now genetic editing, many people, many things you would have heard about them. Like the DNA gets altered, or there is a genetic surgery is being done. So you have the organism's genome, which is replaced or removed on a strand of a DNA. And then you get whatever type of engineered crops you want. Maybe it will not decompose quickly, it is very well shiny, things like that. So that is what you have a genetic editing. Not only that, you also look for a particular thing known as what is a genetic inheritance and what is the dynamics of breeding pipelines. So that also you can very well use it for calculating the weightage of the seeds. So enhanced seed breeding also has to be taken care. That is also done only with the data science. Next, if you just look at after the seeding commences, no, you have to look for the execution. Now here you can see the depth, the spacing between the seeds and the row spacing has to be taken care. So all this is done very accurately only with the data science. So what we ultimately try to say, we want to do more only with the less resources or have a highly capital intensive industry as a farming. That is what people are expected to do. Now, not only that, you have to have a return on your investment and data driven decisions, you know, like when you talk about combining a new generation of automated precision farming with tools like AGDNA, and this AGDNA, this is what we were talking about, the agricultural DNA, you know, so that things there are there in the live market. Okay, let me go on to a next topic, adapt to the climate change. Now here, climate change is a looming concern which has affected the agriculture to a very great extent. Data scientists are working very hard to figure out what are the ways to compensate for the radical climate shift, climate or weather shift. Now, there is one Taiwanese rice farming, where they try to collect all the data through IoT sensor regarding the crucial information about their crops. Then it goes to a database and it helps the farmers to optimize their production cycles even when the climate change makes the task very challenging. And they are able to scrutinize the agricultural soil data to improve their understanding about the how soil contributes to the climate change by releasing greenhouse gases and how the soil data might aid in adapting to a climate change. Though this might seem to be very tricky, you know, they are, the Taiwanese rice yield is increased. Like that, there are many things. I'm just giving you one example, nothing else. Then you have to have a, you can see that corn destroyed by hail, then this is a drought. Now, climate change is not only a global threat, but you have to find out natural factors which will be helpful in rainfall, temperature, wind speed, sunshine, cloud cover, which are all to be taken into consideration before farming under the open sky. Now, why I'm mentioning is farming under the open sky. Right now, most of the activities are done under the sky. There are no closed structures where, like unlike in your vertical farming or urban farming, they do it. So you have to look at the stress with which the plant will be undergoing in terms of air, dew temperature, precipitation and humidity, and how far better or best you can protect them or give them comfort. So you have to, it is not only the crops, but the farmers can also plan times when it can be sowed, how to protect them, how to harvest them, when to harvest, how to store the harvested item, and how to avoid negative weather effects, and how to yield or nullify the losses. All this has to be taken care of. Now, not only that, the weather monitoring, no, it will provide you a set of measurement options about to provide useful information about things like what is your oil, air and soil temperature, relative humidity, soil moisture, rainfall, wind speed and direction, evapotranspiration, and so on. Now, there are certain weather stations you can see, weather stations which will help us in put in the field. They can measure a lot of parameters, whatever I have mentioned right now, and how they work in precision and what is the working range. But all are ultimately boiling down to certain elements of agricultural weather forecast, like what is the amount and type of coverage of sky by clouds, temperature, rainfall, snow, maximum minimum dew point temperatures, humidity, wind speed and direction, low pressure areas, sudden catastrophic changes, all those things. Among them, the weather monitoring definitely has to focus more or emphasize on these particular thing. So here you can see a weather station which is put up in the field. Moreover, these are some of the other parameters which the weather forecast can give you a better thing. What will be the bright hours of sunshine, solar radiation, dew, leaf wetness, plant evaporation, soil moisture, stress condition, advice for irrigation timing, specific information, microclimate, inside crops in specific cases. Now, all these inputs you can give to the farmer based on the data which you have collected from various sources like the ones which has been shown over here. So all these are collected through, not only like this, there are many gadgets, IoT sensor, many things like that, which all ultimately drive your or bring to a data-driven statistical world where you collect all your input data, you fit into the best model, find out the relationship, estimate the model with the parameter, and then train them and forecast them. So this is how you will be able to be resilient to the weather things. Now, there are numerical weather prediction models, which is known as NWP. And these numerical weather prediction models, if you just type the Google also, you can see any search engine. They solve a complex set of mathematical equations. And these equations, no, they are based on physics and how that drives or how air moves, how heat and moisture is exchanged. And this is being used for these models, and two best known NWP models I can mention you here. One is the GFS, which is known as the Global Forecast System, and the other one I can mention is the European Center for Medium Range Weather Forecast, which is known as the ECMWF model. Now, both these models, no, they give you a very good weather predictions. So this is using the data science concept. Next, we will just move on to the next thing, which is your crop disease and pest. Now, in the crop disease and pest, you know, they will be definitely reducing the farmer's profit. So definitely you should know when to administer the pesticide so that it does not have an adverse effect on people, plant or other living things. So a proper analysis has to be made. Now, I can mention you a Brazilian company, which is a AgroSmart. They are doing this very well, and they are completely collecting through the sensors this particular data. They use it and find out what is the type of insect on the crop, what is the quantity, how it can be eradicated, what is the pest control measure which has to be taken cost effectively by the farmer, and how to minimize the environmental effect. All this are helpful. Next is another sale log, just from the smartphone app. Now, this tries to identify the disease which are currently affecting the crops, and they are trying to say how they can be managed. So I've just given you two examples how it is being used. Now, just let us talk about what are the I'm just giving you only the classification techniques. Any algorithm, any data mining algorithm you can use for the disease thing. Now here, just to list a few, you can see the K-nearest, neighbor, SVM, PNN, and fuzzy logic, ANN, they are concerned. All of us know the what purpose each one does it, what are the advantages and disadvantages. Now, why this has been shown here is just to have a idea about what are the different ways by which you can use your data for classifying them. And this is another flow chart which shows you the steps which are involved in modeling of your crop pathogen, where you can see there are a lot of surveys which are taken from the field. The field experiments are being conducted to find out what is the injury and what is the yield loss. And from there, what you can do is you can get the crop growth model with the damage mechanisms, either the process or the parameters. Then model can be verified. So this, you can use it from the field data, from the expected one, you evaluate and then find out how much best you can control them. And this is another data science project which shows you the best disease crop integrated model which is being developed. What are the actions which are needed on this side and what are the areas of improvement which can be done. If you are a researcher, you can just take this area and work out. Now this is looking at another model which tries to depict you how a data science is being effectively used for calculating or finding out the progress of the disease using the mobile app, how plants can be identified and sent to an expert who resides elsewhere and then take a decision. Now next is your drones. Now, rather than drones, I can see unmanned aerial vehicles. Now, in an unmanned aerial vehicles, the benefits are very, very large. It can cover vast area and it can handle very dangerous area, or it can handle a laborious task and a very dangerous task in the sense it has to spray a fertilizer, which is very harmful for personnel to handle. In such cases, you can use these particular things. They not only are used for weeding and for crop maintenance or pest control, there are semi-autonomous or autonomous robots also. Now, this is one particular robot which is known as the Bony Robo. And this is built on how to identify weeds. And it uses a machine learning algorithm. And it also collects the data from the video or from satellite GPS, and that is being used to exactly identify and how to navigate it using a tractor. Now, having just looked at one for one drone or an unmanned aerial vehicle for handling the pest and the weeding, the other requirements for using them can be anything varied from crop management or access only to data which is relevant to the type of crops which are grown, optimization of the resources in terms of land, cost, the process of farming, the ability to interact with separate solutions from one gateway, ability to monitor the return on investment of drone, ability to scale and adapt solution for other crop varieties. So all these are expected from the unmanned aerial vehicles. Now here, this is one particular drone data which takes into actionable insights. The field and objects which are required to monitor are being selected. So the drone is flown across them. They collect all the images. Then using a data analytics, it is sorted. Then only the required data is, relevant data is analyzed. Then you report the results to the integrated tools. Then you automate the operations which are based on data. So the drone data which has been collected, no, that can be put to use for precision mapping like what prescriptions you can generate based on yield map, or you can plan irrigation and drainage repairs. You can track your livestock and control their health. You can detect parasites and fungi before plants are damaged. Even you can count the crops and analyze the state of fields. So like this, the data which you are doing can be used for several work. Now this is a map, I mean a chart, which tells you about the merits of using an IoT combined with a drone, which helps you to between the traditional agriculture and the other thing. Now we were talking about the drones which we are using for the weeding. Let us talk about how it is being done with the planting also. Because for planting, let us finish off with fertilizer and then let us go to the thing. Now when you talk about the fertilizer, okay, let me finish off another point which has to be completed before I pass on to the fertilizer. Next one is bees and drones. Now you will have a food shortage because of certain factors. One factor I can just tell you as an example is the pollination. The pollination, if it is not done in a proper way, a particular yield will not be as expected. So in order to have the pollinator, identify the pollinators and help maintain the production level of agricultural produce, for this also they are using the aerial drones. And then these drones, they can also be used for planting from the air. So they can drop small seedings or plantings in case it cannot be approached. So what they do is like they use a compressed air to fire these capsules. So the seed pods, no, along with the fertilizer and nutrient, you know, like you could have heard about nowadays, no, they are gifting whenever you go for a function, and as a token of appreciation, well, you are being given a gift, which is a tree, or sometimes you are given a mud ball. Now this mud ball will contain seed inside it with all sufficient nutrition. Now you can throw away the mud ball at locations where it can grow into a tree. So that is what the same thing. It is being done at a local level in many places by the volunteers. It is all something related to your reforestation programs. Okay. And not only that, you can use the drones for spraying your fertilizers. Not only imaging, no, it can be used for spraying your fertilizers. Now, when you are talking about this particular drone, which is shown in the figure, now what they do is they use a combination of GPS, laser measurement, ultrasonic positioning, crop spraying, drones. So what happens is these drones are able to adapt to the altitude, location easily, and they adjust to variables like wind speed, topography and the geography. Not only they do the crop, spray the crops with efficiently, they are also able to do it very accurately, and they end up in, I don't say eliminating waste, they try to end up minimizing the waste. So here at the bottom you can see there is a Agras MG which is spraying a field in action. Now this is another thing which is done by the real-time monitoring and analysis. Now these drones, you know, they can take on remote monitoring and analysis of fields and crops. Instead of a team of workers, you just imagine there is a small fleet of drones which spend a few hours rather than the laborious manual workers who spend on their feet or vehicle tracking back and forth, you know, to crop conditions. Now this, whenever you require, you can send the drones, you can find out and you can control it very easily and effectively. And not only that, you can also monitor your natural trends which are happening on the fly. So that you can increase your yield and efficiency. Next is your connected farm or sensors, no? Like that can also be taken into consideration. So we go into the smart farming context. Now, a smart farming is a concept of farming management which is used modern ICT technology to increase the quantity and quality of the product, you know. So the present day farmers, you know, they can use a sensing technology, they can have a software application, or they can have the communication technology, positioning technology, hardware and software systems, or data analytics, all included in the smart farming. So here, as you can see, it is all bundled up in one single stroke. Now, these IoT-based framing cycle, no, farming cycle, no, they end up in providing you observation of various data which can be recorded from the field or even from the whichever location you require. And this data, you can use it. Then you can diagnose the values which are fed to the specific software so that you already have a rule or you have a model which will ascertain what is the condition of the examined object, and you will be able to identify whether there is any necessity or not. So you can make informed and you can take timely decisions and you can implement all your correct treatments. Not only there, even in livestock farming, you can see they are being taken. What is the well-being and what is the health of your cattle, how it is feeding or how it is grazing or it has a disease. All these things you can very well monitor. Next, you can also automate in a smart greenhouse. Now, this is not in the open sky. It is a closed one. So here you can just look at the various sensor. So here everything, you have a lot of sensors. It is an indoor. So all these pick up the concerned variables through the sensor. And then you can manage them. You get all the data. You use the data for making a proper decision. After managing them, what you try to do with the data which you have inferred, you try to control or manage them. Okay. Now, this is one example of a vertical farming which is being done with the help of a data science. Now, here you can very well see, you know, it is an energy intensive system and it integrates almost all the things where data analysis, data collection, automatic control, everything is being done only with the help of a data. Unless data science is there, you cannot do anything. Now, this is an urban agriculture. So these are your inputs for your urban agriculture and these are your output. So this is the process which is being effected. Now, this is an integrated livestock modeling framework which is being used by people too. And this is for a farming system. Okay, now we have been tracking so long and so far. What we are trying to see, we are trying to reduce the labor. How we will reduce the labor? We can use, as we have been pointing out now and then, you need not have a team of workers on the field for whom you will be paying, but you can have a fleet of drones. So you need not bother about any strike or people, they are moving to other professions. So that can be done. Even you can have some vehicles which will have a driverless tractors. So all this reduces the labor. And after having reduced the labor, it will definitely, you have to ensure they are robust and they are automated. Only then we will have a proper thing. Otherwise, we will not be able to have it. And you have AgBot. There is one AgBot, which is a robust backbone of a sensor. And it has an IoT also over there. And these AgBot, you know, they perform, they replace human robot, human labor with automation. So that is one particular thing which I thought I will mention here. Then when you talk about the driverless tractor, you talk about it is capable of including, it is self-sufficient over time, and it has cameras, machine-machine systems, GPS for navigation, IoT connectivity to enable remote monitoring and operation, radar, object detection, avoidance, things like that. All these are all involving intensive big data which has to be handled. Next is insurance of your crops. Now, the Indian agri space is definitely prone to disasters and risks beyond our control. That is why majority of the farmers' livelihood is dependent on the quantity and quality of the yield they produce, and only on produce they will be able to get the money. So what will happen in case they don't have a thing like that? So definitely you have to go for a insurance schemes. Now when you go for the insurance schemes, you can use any technology which can benefit from the crop insurance, like satellite weather forecasting and satellite imagery. They can better equip insurers with early warning of risk, and in turn farmers also can be alerted so that loss can be reduced or prevented. They can use IoT, which will accurately perform the task of collecting information of the health of the soil, crops, and satellite data. And satellites, drone, mobile cameras are highly cost effective. So they can, you can insure the crop. Maybe it is a over a period, or maybe during a particular period. Now, a few months back, you would have heard about all the locust. I don't say they are grasshoppers, locust. They were coming and swarming in groups, and they were trying to completely chop down the final product or the crop. So it was expected a famine will come. So in such a dynamic, what will be the insurance which you can take about? So that also can be decided. Not only that, risk assessment like this. So risk assessment, you know, you can talk about in terms of, you can make predictions about what are the risks which are connected with raising livestock and growing crops. And what is the risk assessment for agriculture in big data powered smart contracts, which you can build using a blockchain platform. Blockchain is another big area in your data science for agriculture, which you can very easily and effectively do it. Nanotechnology is another one, quantum technologies. All these are also being used. But ultimately, they boil down to the data. So unless you have a very good idea about your data science, you can very easily handle all your risk. Now here you can see how the current risk assessment is being done, how they are taken care in one of the field it has been taken down. Then this is the pollution level, how to control and how to effectively look at the risk assessment of the soil pollution. Now this is what we were talking about in terms of the blockchain. Now blockchain, maybe I can just give you a highlight about what blockchains like they take care. Right now when this disruption wave of COVID time, you can see the food restaurants, they have taken a very drastic step. So you can see there is a decline of street food and sparse attendance at restaurants, you can see because of the social distancing. Then there is an increase in takeaway, more home delivery is preferred. Now all these things, it is not only for the food. The same thing, it is applicable to your farm producers. So how that can be taken care and how you can bring it to the from the farm to the desk. So what you can do is you can use a blockchain to keep track of your food traceability and how the ingredients in the food or ingredients in the fresh yield of the crop are maintained, or what is the nutrient value of a harvested fruit or a vegetable, what is it, and whether it has been harvested one day back or 2 days back. That food traceability, you can use it. So there also, no, here you combine with IoT with blockchain, but it still has a data involved in it. So you should be in a position to develop a model and then use it for doing it. Not only that, you can look at the selling to the direct selling. I don't say selling to the market, I can say direct selling to the consumer without any intermediary. That can also be taken care of in your thing. Then packing also, no? You can actively pack. Sometimes you can see the apples which are wax coated and they are sent to the market, and this stays for a much longer time, but it is not healthier in the long run. So that can be avoided by using all this. So there also data is being taken. So this is for the marketing. So marketing linkage. Then supply tracking, no? We were talking about that blockchain and the food traceability. Food traceability, we will talk what is fresh from the farm, whether it is reaching to the consumer desk, how long and what was the flow. Like we track our simple things, no? You send a post by register, you can be tracking, or you pick up a product from a website who delivers something like online shopping, like your Amazon or something, Flipkart. So where it is navigating, where it is, all these can be tracked. Same thing with your food producers. Now there are many more things which also ensure data science, which is your none other than your agricultural niches. What is the ideal crops? What are the consumer expectations? What are the food scarcity, and how to empower very, very small farmers or even household people when they are cultivating, how this can be exchanged. All this requires the data intensive. Now, let me complete the utility part of the data science. But now let us have a quick look at what are the challenges put in front of us. We started with an understanding in 2050, we will have a food increase in the population, but decline in the resources for food. So this is a very big challenge. Now, there is one thing which has been fixed by the UN, and they have said a world with zero hunger. So what are the challenges which we are normally faced? The technical challenges, say, for example, you have an inefficient infrastructure for data collection. Then management of such a humongous data. Then the storage and computational problems, scalability and streaming issues. All these things are challenges where definitely you can do research, you can find out, and you can solve them. Then definitely there are some challenges which are related to the governance, like what the government needs to have a consistent dynamic approach, constant evaluation regarding the policies and how they are getting percolated to the low level. Another thing is net neutrality and the data privacy, which is also concerned. So there is another outcry on data privacy and net neutrality when everything goes open. So that also you need to take care. Data security, because data is on the flow. So there might be different leakages. So when there is a leakage, you might not be in a proper position to properly make a decision making. So you have to ensure that is also ruled out. So what are the opportunities for data-based solutions? farmers, no, they can raise a variety of crop. They need to plan, and they should decide on irrigation, fertilizer, pesticides, time to reap, harvest, send the products to the market. All this was an arbitrary science earlier, but now it is not like that. Anything can be localized, anything can be done. So the data which is available from the new technologies can be properly utilized then, and you can ensure even at the molecular level, you can use it. Say, for example, we were talking about the fruit. Let us talk about the horticulture, where you are using a RFID chip to your to a poultry or to a any other thing for harvesting the meat. And you talk about some devices which are being attached to the fruits also to sense and how they are being done. So the opportunity is, no, you can increase the farm productivity by properly forecasting crop production and improving the crop yields. You can improve the farming operations by consuming aptly the resources like water, electricity, things like that. Then you can stop migration of the labor force. Now what happens is data-driven farming, no, technology can be central, but it is more attractive for specialists and prevent them from searching for other operations. And definitely our country is a very, very good agricultural country. And what happens is there is a robust demand. Because of this robust demand, definitely you can use all the technology, and using the technology at the farming level will not be possible by all the farmers. So definitely there are a lot of opportunities for people or for new people entering there. So that can also support the policy of export, and it can have a proper advantage. So India has that particular advantage. Now you have to ensure that there is a less wastage of food, and you have to ensure greater investments are attracted to the agri-tech. Now there are several use cases. I think lack of time, maybe in another section, if time permits, I can go through all this. But you can just have a look at what are the real-time tools which are being used. So you can read for yourself. So all these are relevant to your data. So let me conclude. So these are certain real-time use cases. And also we were trying to show you how one can use a data science in the work of an agricultural field right now. And in the future, no, you can very easily predict what opportunities it can bring. And technology, no, definitely it has played a very huge role in developing this particular industry. And today it is possible to grow crops even in a desert. And thanks to the agricultural biotechnology and things like that, which are helping us to do that. And another thing in future, what we can try to do is, like access to the internet still remains not the most critical component for unlocking the possibility of new technologies. So you have to have an access across the globe, no, smartphones, which can create access or opportunity to access information and services, online media, social media, online videos, so that there is a seamless, cost-effective communication among the smallholder farmers and other key agricultural stakeholders who can be your extension officers, agro-dealers, retailers, agricultural researchers, policy makers, and all these things. And you can also try to ensure development of devices which will be able to capture the data and do a decision at that particular site. Now, battery power will be very, very less. when you are using a remote device of a sensor. So you can use some non-conventional energy, or how to store the energy which is there, how it is streaming, and what will happen to the data in transit. All these things, you know, there are a lot of potential works can be done in this particular area. And so today, in a nutshell, we were trying to focus on to what is the necessity of the hour. By 2050, we will have a population which is an increase than the current. Food produce has to be more to provide them with a proper, balanced, nutritious diet. So to do that, we have to increase our agricultural production. Though there are many, many technologies, ultimately all these technologies are boiling down to the data. Unless you handle these data in a proper way, you cannot get the information or the concerned knowledge from the information or an wisdom which can be utilized for making a proper decision making. So definitely you need to look at the various models which are available, which is the very good apt model for that, and also look at the algorithms which can be utilized, the tools which are already developed, what can be enhanced, what cares to be created. And you have to look at the various components or the elements that make up the agricultural produce. So we started with the soil, then we started with water, then drones, fertilizer, and we slowly navigated to the other points, like we were talking in terms of disease, yielding the produce, then labor, risk, seeding, genetics, supply tracking. All this we were navigating through, how data science has improved from the traditional to the modern and how it can be progressed. And finally, we ended up trying to focus on to the challenges which are there, where India stands, what are the opportunities for Indians to work on more on this, and how you can better what can be said is how to lure the youngster or the young population to these technologies, which will help us in producing more and more sustainable and very good food for the future generation. So that is left up to the teachers or the researchers or scientists like us, who can lure them or who can inspire them. And there are a lot of opportunities for us also to dive into this and to make not only India and to make a heaven on earth as a data scientist. So with this, let me conclude for the session. Any questions you can ask me? Any questions?
Ma'am, am I audible, ma'am? Am I audible to all? Hello. Sakha sir, am I audible? Hello.
Yes, you are audible.
Yes.
Yeah. Any questions, please ask sir, or put in the chat box. Ma'am, Sri Devi ma'am has asked what type of data and how it is used.
Your voice is with some noise.
What type of data can be handled and how can be used?
See, there are a lot of open access repositories which are available. Now you can try with your, if you are developing a model or if you are trying some algorithm or if you are trying to do something new or enhance the existing one, there are a lot of repositories which are there in the net or in the search engines. You can use them to navigate and find them out, or even universities, they have it. You can take them and you can find out if in case you are using a simulation. And
After having ensured it is perfect, then you can put your prototype into the field. And into the field, after having done that, you observe, do a proper matching and then take it. Any data is available, anything. You can always navigate and find it out. If you have difficulty, you can contact us.
Okay, ma'am. Any other questions you can ask? I think there are no questions. Ma'am, thank you, ma'am. Actually, you have given us a wonderful session, starting from the soil and the air. That is, from the scratch, you have taken it. Ma'am, it was very wonderful. As we do the research with data science, we do projects, and we encourage our students to do projects in that. I think this session will be very useful for us. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much for giving us a wonderful session. Actually, you have delighted us with a couple of knowledge. So we have acquired more knowledge on what is data science, how to do this. Because everybody, we know about what is data science, all these things. But you have done a great job by giving us from the scratch, and we are able to do in whatever ways we can apply the data science in the field. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And in case you have any difficulties or you have any queries, you are always welcome, because knowledge is something which has to be shared among our community. And these are my contact details. Thank you. And I am signing off.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dear participants, we have shared the... Hello. We have shared the day one attendance link for session 2 and 3 as well as the feedback line. Please fill it out. And we will be doing the attendance link, we will be doing only the chat box. Today I will be sharing the WhatsApp group. From tomorrow it will be shared only in the meeting. Okay, only in the meeting it will be shared. Thank you, thank you. As soon as we finish it, please acknowledge it and sign up. Sir,
yeah, ma'am, shared, ma'am. Already shared the link.
Okay. I have posted again, you can see. I even posted the WhatsApp group. Please fill the tomorrow session details will be shared in the WhatsApp group itself. But for your information, I can say that tomorrow session starts at 10 o'clock. The first session will be from 10 to 11:30. Shraddha sir, am I audible, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
First session will be from 10 to 11:30. And it will be on NV software. And it will be given by CSIR scientist, Ms. Ubasina. Okay, she is from Chandigarh. She will be giving it. And she will be giving NV software. Actually, we will work on Tableau and all these things. So she will be giving on NV. Okay, NV software. The next session is from 12 to 1:30. And it will be from information retrieval and how the information retrieval, the theory and practice by Dr. Karan Verma, NIT Delhi. The third session will be from 2 to 3:30 and it will be on analytics of crop detection and disease detection. And it will be given by Dr. E. Shivashankar from NIT Trichy. So tomorrow it will be more on practicals because the Urvasi ma'am and Shankar sir has been, Shankar sir, he's been working on these projects for the last one decade. So they will be very it will be very helpful for us to go with the practical things. Okay. So tomorrow the session will start at 10 o'clock. Kindly join the session at 10 o'clock. If you have any queries, post in the WhatsApp group. And kindly go with your email ID and everything which you have given in your profile. Because the attendance will be activated only in that thing, and your certificate will also be given in that thing only. If you have anything change in your email ID, please share it because I have to say to the agile office. Thank you. Thank you, Rubina. I'll try to get the PPTs from both the speakers. I have asked them, they told that they'll share it also. Or otherwise, recordings of today's session will be available in our YouTube link. I'll share the YouTube link after uploading it by 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock. I will be sharing the YouTube link. You can see it in that.